tonight. We thank thee for the wonderful privilege of being engaged with thy Son. He is the object of your delight. And indeed, what a delight it is this morning for us to be engaged with him. We can say, our God and Father, that he is altogether lovely. We love him and we desire to worship him. We desire to give him his right place in our lives, to give him his right place in the assembly. We give thee thanks as we ask these favors. Even now we pray that thou would speak to thy servant by thy Spirit. Encourage the hearts of the saints towards the person of the Lord Jesus, that they might become attached to him. We give thee thanks as we pray, as we ask these favors and mercies. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
In Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. Verse 32. Let's read from verse 31 of Acts chapter 2, verse 31. He, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Jesus, or Christ, that his soul was not left in hell, neither his flesh did see corruption. This Jesus has God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father, the promise of the Holy Ghost, he hath shed forth this which ye now see and hear. Then in the very Acts chapter 5, verse 31. Let's read from verse 30. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. Him that God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And then in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 1, verse 8, but unto the Son he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, a scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. The Lord Jesus was rejected here in this world. He is the rejected man. The world gave him a cross. The world, as it were, said that they would prefer Barabbas rather than the Lord Jesus Christ. They rejected him. They despised him. They killed him. This is the testimony of the scriptures, that they have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. But beloved, this Lord Jesus, and this was the testimony and the preaching of Peter, that this same Jesus Christ that men have crucified, that Christ and men, as it were, put in a tomb. And they sealed the tomb. And this morning I have to say to my son that the angels, you know, the angels came and they have to remove that stone. Not because God, as it were, wanted to see in the tomb. No, the stone was removed so that you and I can see. That those who would go there would see that he is not there. He is risen. So the world rejected him. But you know, beloved, if you were paying careful attention to those scriptures, the two scriptures, there's another one in Philippians chapter 2. You see that the Lord Jesus is exalted. That the Lord Jesus is exalted by God. The Lord Jesus is in that exalted place in the glory of God. He's exalted, as a matter of fact, in Ephesians chapter 4. He exalts himself. He ascends up into that place of greatness and supremacy and power and majesty. He ascends to that place. The same one who came down is the same one who has ascended up into that high place. And I want to say, beloved, this morning that the place that he occupies, not even the angels can occupy that place. Unto which of the angels said, God, at any time, sit thou on my right hand until I make my enemies my footstool. The Lord Jesus is the only one who can occupy that place. And the place that he occupies in the glory of God, there's nothing higher than that. But also, there's no other person who can occupy that place. He's exalted. And you know, if you were here last Wednesday, I was sharing the thought about the throne of God. And we see that the throne of God brings before us the thought of the supremacy of God, the undisputed authority of God. And I read the verse in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8, to show that as God, he never left the throne. This is wonderful to see. You see, everything that is given to him as a man. As God, he doesn't need anything to be given to him. He never ceased to be what he was when he became what he was not. He is God, blessed forever. He sits on the throne, and God the Father can speak of him, speak about him, but also God the Father can speak to him. Thy throne, O God, is forever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hate iniquity. Therefore, thy God has anointed thee with the oil of gladness. This is as a man. He's anointed us with the oil of gladness above his fellows. The Lord Jesus is in that exalted place. And this morning, we are privileged to remember him, to give him that place, to give him that knowledge that he is in that place of exaltation. The question is asked, why there's a need to exalt him? You know, you go to the Old Testament scriptures and you will see that the Lord Jesus is exalted. Isaiah saw him in Isaiah chapter 6. Daniel saw him in Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. Ezekiel saw him in Ezekiel chapter 1. But why is there a need for him to be exalted? Because he became a man. And this is the truth of Philippians chapter 2. That this one who is co-equal with God the Father, this one who has the same divine substance as God the Father, became a man and died. He became lower than the angels, not because he became a man. He became lower than the angels because of death. Death. What a lovely man to talk about Christ. To talk about the greatness of Christ. Not only is the throne of God in Ezekiel, we find Ezekiel saw the throne first, then he saw the Son of Man who's sitting on the throne. Isaiah saw the Lord first, and then he saw the greatness of his throne. The scripture makes much of the place that he occupied. God did not put him in a sheep pen. God did not put him in some place that is of no renown. God puts him in the highest place. There's no place above that. He is not only occupying the highest place in the glory, but he, as it were, has the highest place on earth. This is the truth of Colossians. He is the firstborn of every creature. He not only has the highest place in heaven, but beloved, the Lord Jesus has the highest place on earth. What a person he is! What a lovely person! Person of the Lord Jesus. But here in Hebrews, I believe it's an answer to the question as to his rights to sit at God's right hand. Notice in verse, let me read from verse 1. God, who at sundry time and in diverse manner spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophet. You know, there are many speakers in this book. And I want to say it to you before I read any further, that this book of Hebrews presents the greatness of Christ. He is greater than Moses. He is greater than the angels. He's greater than the prophets. He's greater than the Levitical system. He's greater than the sacrifices and the offering. He is superior to all of these things that are connected to the Jewish system. He is superior. And this is the intent of this book, to show the greatness of Christ. As a matter of fact, that word is used. It means mega in the Greek. That the Lord Jesus is greater than Joshua, he's greater than Moses, he's greater than the angels. And that's why you have great salvation. And that is why you have God, the greatness of God's self. When it comes to him making an oath, he could swear by nothing greater but himself, because God is great. You have a great high priest. The greatness and the majesty. As a matter of fact, in the Hebrew, in the Greek, greatness really means majesty. They were a witness of his greatness. So the Lord Jesus, God is speaking. There are many speakers in this book, but God is the most important speaker, because what God is saying is that his Son is God. His Son is entitled. You know, notice that when you go to the Old Testament and you hear about Joseph being exalted to this place of greatness, I think it's Genesis chapter 40, verse 41, where you see Jacob being exalted to this place of greatness, Pharaoh would say to him, listen to me, I am greater than you in this throne. But when it comes to divine persons, you don't have that kind of dialogue. You don't have that kind of exchange, that I am greater than you. Lord Jesus, who is co-equal with God the Father, when it comes to this matter of death, he does not make that a matter of contention. His equality with God the Father is not an issue of contention, because you know who he is. Becoming Lord and the angels doesn't become an issue of contention with him, because he never will never cease to be who he is when he became what he was not. But he will remain a man forever. He will remain a man forever, having become a man. So God speaks to him, speak about him, and speaks to him. And this one, he has the right. Here, and let me point out this distinction in the book of Hebrews. You'll find that he sits down in chapter 1, because of who he is, right? He sits down there because of who he is. Notice what the scripture says about who he is. Verse 2, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, who he has appointed heir of all things, so he's heir of all things. All things belong to him by right. All things were created for him, and without him nothing was made that was made. All things, so the Lord Jesus Christ is the heir of all things in heaven and earth. By whom also he made the world, he is the creator of the world. Verse 3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. This is actually saying that he is the perfect expression of God. He is the substance. You know, people get hung up with this thought of the image, that the image doesn't necessarily mean that it is the represent, it is actually the same thing. But this is not the thought in the Greek. The fact that the word is used in the sense that in him is the fullness of Godhead. In him, in this person, is all the substance that belongs to God. He's omnipotent. He is omniscient. He's omnipresent. He's all-knowing. All the divine substance belongs to him. He is the exact representation of God, and because of who he is. And let me say also, not because you do not see the greatness of God, or the greatness manifested, or the attributes of God shown out, that doesn't mean that he's not God. So even if you do not see the attributes, like why he was here in this world, there are many people who saw an ordinary man. Did that mean that he wasn't God? No. He never ceased to be who he was when he became what he was not. So he, because of the greatness of his person, he can sit down at the right hand of the majesty on high. You read further on in the chapter, you see that there is an invitation for him to sit. But here he can sit down because of the greatness of him, his own self. You know, you talk about the greatness of men. Men are great in many respects. There's some men who can run very fast. There's some men, they're very intelligent. They can put things together. And so many things you can think about that speaks about the greatness of man. When you put all the greatness of man, you put all the accolades of man together, it cannot exceed the greatness of the person of the Lord Jesus. Mm-hmm. He is altogether lovely. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We should love him more. And I want to say, if there be any person here in this place who know not Christ as personal Lord and Savior, I want to introduce you to this great man who is touched by the feelings of your infirmity. This great man who became an offering for sin. We sang this morning that he was made sin for me. He was made sin for you. He alone, do you know that he alone could carry the burden of sin? Only he alone can remove sin. But also, and this is the beauty of the book of Zechariah, not all men can bear greatness. I say, there's a philosopher who said that absolute power, I think it was Machiavelli, who said absolute power corrupts absolutely. Not all people. You have to control people who have power. And I want to say that you know the Lord Jesus. All power is given to him. All power is given to him because this man can control. And this is the truth of Zechariah. Only he can bear the glory. You know, weight. Glory is a heavy, weighty thing. Only he alone can bear the glory. He, as God, blessed forever. This blessed man can occupy that place of supremacy, that place at the right hand of the majesty in the heavens. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 8. Now of the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such a high priest who is set down on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. He's a minister of the sanctuary. So the Lord Jesus can sit there we will see further on because of what he has done. But here it is not what he has done, it is what he is doing. And this is very important to see. There's no other man in the universe that can do what he is doing. And could you imagine if you read the thesis of the Apostle Paul? He's making the conclusion in the middle of his argument. He's making the conclusion in the middle of his argument. Because if you go on further, you'll see he's still making points about the priest. But yet, in chapter 8, you go into chapter 9, he's still talking about the greatness of the priest, comparing the priest with the Lord Jesus. Right? In chapter 7, he talks about the priest being superior, Christ being superior to Aaron. You have a type in Melchizedek. Let's read a few verses there in chapter 7. Verse 3. So this is talking about Melchizedek. He's without father, without mother, without descent, without having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like, who is he made like? Like unto the Son of God that abideth a priest continually. Notice also verse 15. And it is yet far more evident for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth among another priest. He is the other priest. Who is made not after the law of carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. He lives forever. He lives forever. Why does he live forever there? Because he has a function to perform. He is there. Notice verse 23. This is glorious truths, beloved. There truly were many priests because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continued forever, has an unchangeable priesthood, wherefore he is able, hallelujah, he is able to save. And I want to say that the Lord Jesus is there. At God's right hand, he is the only man that has the power to save the saints when they're in trouble. He has the power to save the unbeliever, even though I don't think that this truth is there. But he has the power to save. He has a function. And there's this man who's there at God's right hand in the glory. He can save us to the uttermost. You know, Mr. Darby says he can save us completely. And this is the truth. So not only is he a priest that is presently doing, he's a minister of a sanctuary. And notice in verse 6, he has an excellent ministry. He has an excellent ministry. His ministry is to save us, to save those of us, to deliver us, those of us who would call upon him. So his present ministry is what he's doing presently. By virtue of who he is and by virtue of what he's doing right now, there's no other man who is capable of doing what the Lord Jesus Christ can do. No, there's no other man who can perfect our praises. And you go on in the chapter, since he's a minister of the sanctuary and he has somewhat to offer, what does he offer to God? It is what we offer to him. So he saves on one hand, and also he offers up our prayers and praise. As we oftentimes say that he adds to our prayers and prayers sweet perfume. He is the one who perfects our prayer. So he sits at the right hand of God, and hear the expression, the right hand of the throne of God, because of what he is doing. Notice in chapter 10. Verse 12. But this man, that is the Lord Jesus. It is good to read the contrast in verse 11. But every priest standeth daily ministering and offering often the same sacrifice, which can never take away sins. But this man, after He has offered one sacrifice for sin, forever sat down on the right hand of God. This is because he sits there because of what he has done in relation to our sins. Who could have taken away our sins? Could you take away your sins? Let's say salvation was dependent on how much wealth you had, or how many education you had, or which family you belong to. Thank God, salvation is found in no other person but the person of the Lord Jesus, who, as it were, addressed the question of our sins once and for all, to the satisfaction of the heart of God, that he can sit down, unlike the priest who ministered in the Aaronic system of things. He could not sit, he had to stand daily. But Jesus, because of the perfect sacrifice of himself, he can sit down in perpetuity. And not only that, we have an eternal redemption in the blessed person of the Lord Jesus. Here he sits because of what he has done. And then I think in Hebrews 12, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking on to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is now set down at the right hand of the throne of God. God, in answer to this honor that men give to him, give his blessed son. The reward for his suffering was glory. The reward for his rejection and this despising here in this world is glory. So the Lord Jesus is honored by God. He's given this place of glory at the right hand of the majesty on high. Would to God that our hearts would become more engaged with the wonderful person of the Lord Jesus. He wants to draw our hearts and our affections towards him. You know, we have a lot of troubles in this life. There's a lot of great men in this world. But let us always keep in our minds, keep before our gaze, the greatness and the majesty and the glory of the Son of God. So the Lord Jesus is above all. He's exalted to that high place in the glory of God. He has ascended there. You know, in Hebrews, he sits down there because of who he is in his person. When you get to the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 20, it is God who in the greatness of his power sets him down. So he's enthroned by God. God, in other words, is saying that my son who has magnified me in the face of death in this world, he is deserving of that place of highest honor, not only in the heavens, not only on earth, not only in this world, but in the world to come. May he receive from our hearts all that he deserves for the honor, praise, and glory of God.